Ladies and gentlemen, Reverend Fathers, sisters and brothers in St. Dominic, it's my very great pleasure to welcome all of you here this evening to this annual lecture in honor of Bartolome de las Casas, the 16th century Dominican friar who championed the rights of the indigenous peoples of the Americas and who is the inspiration for our institute. The Las Casas Institute for Social Justice looks primarily now at hard questions in four urgent areas for reflection, to do with human rights and dignity, to do with economics as a moral science, to do with questions of migration and questions of poverty here in the United Kingdom. This is technically the 2016 annual Las Casas lecture, but we have judiciously deferred it until today to gladden your heart and fire your minds on a day when a cold wind otherwise blows across the Atlantic. I've asked our brother, Father Timothy Radcliffe, the former director of the Institute and indeed former master of the Order of Preachers, if he would introduce our speaker this evening. So, Father Timothy, could I ask you to come up, please, and introduce the Archbishop?
Good evening. I think Archbishop Rowan must be absolutely fed up listening to people saying that he needs no introduction. And it's true. I'm sure that you're all aware, more or less, of his great achievements and gifts. I'd like to stress just one of them this evening as we welcome him, and that he is something which is quite rare. He is a charitable theologian. Now, you might have thought it obvious that since the job of a theologian is to talk about the God who is love, that you'd expect them to be charitable, but it's not always the case. There's even a thing called odium theologicum, theological hatred, which is a particular form of rancor among theologians. And theologians in the past weren't past putting a little bit of poison in each other's chalices. And of course, this year we celebrate the 500th anniversary of the Reformation, where theologians often condemned each other to the stake and to be hanged and drawn and quartered. But you can only be a great theologian, as Rowan is, if you are charitable. Otherwise, it would be like trying to be an art historian who's colorblind. And the Archbishop's charity doesn't consist in having nice, warm, fuzzy feelings about people with whom he disagrees. Rather, his charity lies in his commitment to engage people with whom he disagrees with all his intelligence in the hope of learning from them and teaching them. Rowan has the acuity of a philosopher and the sensitivity of a poet. Though one of my brethren, Brian Davis, was sitting in a bus and he heard two women in front of him arguing and bemoaning their terrible lots in life. And one of them said, "Well, you've got to be philosophical about it." And the other one said, "Philosophical, what does that mean?" And she said, "Well, it means you don't think about it." All over the world, as we see this rise in populism, and as Father Richard said, any moment now the president-elect is about to become the president, we see a retreat from complexity to simplistic slogans. In such a time, more than ever, we need teachers who are charitable and subtle and intelligent, of whom there is none better in Britain than Archbishop Rowan. Who better to talk about political liberty and religious liberty a new look. Thank you very much.
Thank you so very much for so unmeritedly generous an introduction, and thank you all for being here this evening. It's a great honor for me to be invited to address this audience and have the chance to reflect a little bit on what I think is perhaps more than even when I offered the title, a rather timely and pressing set of concerns. By liberty, I mean the assurance that every man shall be protected in doing what he believes his duty against the influence of authority and majorities, custom and opinion. The state is competent to assign duties and draw the line between good and evil only in its immediate sphere. So wrote Lord Acton in 1877. The text comes from a lecture which he delivered in Shropshire, apparently to a very mixed audience of local squires and shopkeepers who were somewhat stretched by an hour and a half of political philosophy. But Acton was a man who took no prisoners where his audiences were concerned. I hope I may not imitate him in that, at least. But in this lecture, as in so much of his work, Lord Acton, arguably the greatest English historiographer, theoretician of history in the 19th century. In this lecture, as elsewhere, Acton makes the point that political liberty and religious liberty belong inseparably together. Religious liberty, he says, is the foundation of all other political liberties. And a little later in the lecture that I've already referred to, he speaks of political liberty as in turn the condition of religious well-being, the health of religious communities. Notice how he puts it in the lecture. The assurance that every man shall be protected in doing what he believes his duty. The state is the guardian of conscience. The state is the authority that permits you to follow your conscience. But when the state claims the right to dictate the content of your conscience, you begin to have a problem. State and religious community are obligated to one another. If one is to be free, the other must be free. And the state has an obligation not only to respect conviction, conscience, especially the conscience of a minority, it also has an obligation not to be swallowed up by any religious body and not to assimilate itself to a kind of religious body. The state doing its job, in other words, is not a church. The state guards the possibility of there being churches, communities of conviction, of conscience. And the existence of these communities of conscience stands before the state as a challenge and a reminder of what the state is and is not. Liberty, political liberty, is a condition for religious flourishing. Religious conviction is a condition for political liberty. It's a very 19th century perspective, not one you'd have expected in political and religious discourse much before then, and arguably an insight which we still need to be thinking about and clarifying for ourselves. It seems at first rather counterintuitive to say that religion can flourish only when the state as such isn't religious. That's to say, when the state acknowledges that its job is not to enforce or even to encourage a particular kind of religious conviction. I speak, of course, as a member of a church whose record in this respect has been, let's say, patchy over the centuries. and those who formed the identity of the Church of England in the 16th and 17th centuries particularly, would have been very puzzled by this. I think that what they say, in fact, has more theological integrity than you might give it credit for, but I'm not here primarily to apologize for Anglican history. There's only, after all, about 40 minutes left. It's a patchy record, but interestingly, it comes up in the rather unlikely shape of a throwaway remark by T.S. Eliot in his essay on the idea of a Christian society, where he says that he would prefer to have a competent atheist running a country than an incompetent believer. That's to say, the state has its business. It is competent, says Acton, to assign duties and draw the line between good and evil in its immediate sphere. The state has the task of discerning what is good for this community, this political system. The state, in other words, is pragmatic, reflective, but not itself an instrument of theological conformity. But once again, putting the other side of the coin, the state is itself most fully when it's faced with the absolute limits that are posed to it by religious loyalty. The state, in other words, needs something within its life which speaks of loyalties that are not political. When a state believes and acts on the belief that there are no loyalties more serious than political loyalties, the state becomes idolatrous and diabolical. Thus, the presence within the state of communities of non-negotiable conviction is, unexpectedly, the best thing that could happen to a state. A state faced with communities which deny its absolute and universal reach is benefiting from that. Once the state recognizes that there are within it communities that it doesn't, so to speak, franchise, that don't derive their legitimacy and their meaning from the state will have reason to hesitate over any attempt to assimilate all communities to itself. The state will have reason to be cautious of any policy that tries to homogenize, totalize, and control. Acton's view, expressed maddeningly in fragments, occasional lectures, and notes that he left to be read after his death, Acton's view came into 20th century political philosophy, partly through a kind of apostolic succession in the University of Cambridge in its history faculty. And the Anglican theologian John Neville Figgis of the Community of the Resurrection in Yorkshire, who flourished about a century ago, developed some of Acton's ideas, insisting on what he called the idea of the free church in the free state, insisting that all you needed to make a state a champion of liberty was a community within it, insisting on its own liberty over against the state. The state, recognizing its limits, would become more fully itself. But it's not only within the bounds of the Cambridge History School that these points were made, and not only in the draughty church halls of Shropshire that the point was made. In the 1930s, Dietrich Bonhoeffer began to develop his thoughts on political ethics, thoughts which ended on a gallows in a concentration camp in 1945. But in the unfinished draft of his great work on ethics, which he regarded as potentially the most important thing he had to say, he articulates something strikingly and surprisingly similar to what Acton says, that the church is necessary to the state. Religious liberty is necessary for a liberal society in the widest possible sense of the word. And, says Bonhoeffer, this doesn't mean that the church is then obligated to defend its rights and privileges within a society. Quite the contrary. But the church, simply by being what it is, speaks to a state claiming more than it has a right to claim. And in the Germany of the late 1930s, that was no academic issue. Acton regarded himself as standing in a venerable theological tradition. In spite of what I said a few minutes ago about the way in which his idiom and his expression are not what you'd expect before the 19th century, he was himself very keen to underline the continuity of what he was saying with the political thinking of St. Thomas Aquinas. He has quite a lot to say about how Aquinas is one of the first real theorists of popular sovereignty in European history. That's to say, Aquinas has a theory, a theologically informed theory of representative government, of the rights of protest, the dignity of minorities, and the necessary limitations on the freedom of monarchs. The whole nation ought to have a share in government itself. I'm quoting again. The constitution ought to combine a limited and elective monarchy with an aristocracy of merit, and such an admixture of democracy as shall admit all classes to office by popular election. This language, Acton goes on, which contains the earliest exposition of the Whig theory of the revolution, is taken from the works of St. Thomas Aquinas. He would no doubt have paused for an intake of breath from the Shropshire squires. But he sees his political approach as standing in the tradition of St. Thomas, chiefly because he sees a continuity in Christian thought of resistance to political absolutism. And when he speaks of and insists upon the rights of the people, that's what he has in mind. But as soon as you use an expression like the people, you are, of course, raising a very complex set of issues. It's very easy to take language about the people as sanctifying a kind of majority tyranny. And that's why I emphasize the fact that for Acton, the insistence on the rights and liberties of the people is the people against absolutism, not the majority against the minority. And to make an obvious contemporary point, the popularity currently of language about the will of the people suggests that this is a lesson that still has to be learned in some quarters. But Acton also sees the risks, and he writes about them here and in later work, the risks of a liberalism that sees itself as a substantive program rather than the creation of a climate in which you can make a principled defense of diversity and freedom of conscience. That's to say, liberalism, which has itself become a program, becomes something which is in danger of being an orthodoxy imposed by the liberal state. Acton's ideal is very different. The liberal state does not have a moral agenda except the preservation of the liberty of all its constituent communities. Communities, not just individuals. The liberal state is one in which communities of conviction can argue freely and honor their consciences. And Acton is already, in the last quarter of the 19th century, expressing deep discontent with what was fast becoming a liberal orthodoxy in 19th century Europe. That is the identity of the state and the nation. and his interest in pluralism within the political world is an interest, among other things, in the possibilities of a healthy federalism rather than a narrow nationalism. A state where national, cultural, ethnic identity is not the same thing as the identity of a citizen is likely to be a healthy state, because once again it admits that political belonging, political identity, political loyalty will not be the only thing that matters in a society. There will be other kinds of affiliation, there will be other kinds of relationship which need their own cultivation, their own strengthening. The nation state will always risk insisting that one kind of loyalty covers everything else, and though it's perhaps an awkward word to use just today, trumps everything else. So Acton throughout his life was interested in how political federations worked. Federations of nations in a state which, by its very nature, guaranteed a diversity of liberty, counterbalancing racial and cultural forms of oppression. So, late in life, once again, he had things to say about the political climate in the last days of Victoria and the early days of the 20th century. The theory of nationality is a retrograde step in history. Making the state and the nation commensurate with each other practically reduces to a subject condition other nationalities within the frontiers. So says his biographer, summarizing Acton's late observations. And yet another great Cambridge historian, G.M. Trevelyan, wrote much later that he had great difficulty understanding Acton's unease about nation states until the 1930s. I remember his saying to me that states based on the unity of a single race, like modern Italy and Germany, would prove a danger to liberty. I did not see what he meant at the time, but I do now. So, I've begun these reflections by taking you through some of Acton's ideas, because it seems to me, and I'll elaborate a bit further later, that to understand why religious liberty matters must be, for the religious commentator, something more than just insisting on the rights and privileges of religious bodies. It has to be something which is defended, argued, and explored for the sake of the well-being of a liberal and pluralist society. Not because there is some all-conquering ideology called liberalism, but because the state which knows its business and knows its limits is one in which the liberal recognition of the right of conscience is paramount. In his Cambridge inaugural lecture as Professor of Modern History in 1895, Acton summarizes some of the tests of a truly free society. It's one in which, he says, there is some kind of organized representative government. That is, government has a claim to be legitimate because it is representative. And universally representative, not representative simply of factions. It's a society in which there is no such thing as slavery. A society which encourages and preserves freedom of speech. And not least, a society which guarantees the protection of every minority and the dignities and liberties of the weakest. All of that belongs to its freedom. In other words, there's no point in trying to talk about freedom in society without talking about the dignities and liberties of minorities. No point in talking about freedom if, alongside talking of free speech and so forth, you speak about proper representative structures. And as he says in that lecture, the recognition of freedom of conscience is fundamental for all the other freedoms that you might want to talk about. Part then of the new look at religious liberty and political liberty that I'd like to encourage, rising from a reading of Acton, has to do with this sense of the mutual service, the symbiosis of the ideals of political liberty and religious liberty. Part of it has to do, as I've said, with understanding the claim for religious liberty, not so much as a claim for exemption from the state's interference, but service to the state's integrity, a reminder to the state of its limited role and limited right. For Acton, as for others who would want to reflect in this vein, there is, of course, a strong theological undercurrent. And in the Shropshire Lecture of 1877, Acton begins to sketch some of what that might mean in relation to scriptural history. Our story as Christians, and indeed as Jews, begins, says Acton, with the story of God drawing human beings into communities of a more than merely local or ethnic character. Covenanted communities. Communities that are held together by a shared sense of God's promise. And within such communities, the radical and absolute character of our obligation to one another, the obligation of mutual respect and mutual service, is grounded on the unconditional character of God's relation to every person. That, says Acton, is the story of community life that we tell as believers in the Judeo-Christian tradition. A story about God's initiative in shaping a certain kind of community. God's initiative in embodying, in human terms, something of that absolute, what should we call it? Absolute attention, which the divine eye gives to every creature, and particularly every human creature. God's gaze upon each thing that God has made and each person that God has made. This then is a community in which human dignity is something that cannot be intelligibly compromised. There is something non-negotiable about this status as the object of God's regard. And the customs and the laws of these communities are customs and laws that seek to enshrine that divine regard, that divine concentration upon human persons. That, says Acton, is one of the examples of how human togetherness precedes the life of states. The state comes later on the scene. Not necessarily chronologically, but theologically. Communities that begin, that find their origin and their rationale in this granting of absolute status to one another, these communities are, for all sorts of reasons, swept up in administrative units, institutional patterns and structures, which are not themselves theological. But if these larger, later units, political units in a narrower sense, don't take for granted the continuing existence and integrity of the communities in which absolute recognition of human dignity exists, then those larger units will become corrupt, oppressive, one-dimensional. Hence Acton's twofold conclusion about the necessary limit to the claims of the state if the state is truly to be itself. As conversely, the need for the state to have a procedural integrity, a distance from a moral and religious agenda, represented by the rule of law, which guarantees the space for communities of conviction. But it's all that, it's the densely structured and textured recognition of human dignity, human status, the human being as the object of divine regard. It's all of that which makes the coexistence of communities and persons within the state more than a mere matter of tolerance. Tolerance alone is, for all its popularity in the educational world, a very thin value to promote. Respect or reverence, the recognition of non-negotiable depth and dignity in other persons, needs more than just a habit of putting up with other people. And the religious component in a complex society is, or should be, one in which that positive, three-dimensional sense of human dignity and status is allowed to flourish. Informing, challenging, stretching and enlarging the state's commitment to legal equality and toleration. Legal equality and toleration are absolutely necessary, and they need to be fleshed out with something of the narrative of divine regard and absolute dignity. The state, you could say, by acknowledging the presence of communities of religious conviction, gives room in itself for a real reverence for human beings, not only tolerance. The illiberal state, which denies such space or pushes religious conviction purely into the private sphere, ends by instrumentalizing its citizens and seeing them as no more than agents of the state's purposes and subjects of the state's decisions. And the instrumentalizing of citizens is one of the things which every self-respecting state bureaucracy constantly seeks to promote, and every self-respecting citizens' organization seeks to resist. I'd say in passing that there are obvious difficulties here which we mustn't ignore. Difficulties for church and state. I've been arguing in these remarks for a picture of the church as a community of conscience recognized by the state, which thereby recognizes the limits of its own power to control. And the same would be true of other religious communities. But what happens when the state is faced with a church whose convictions lead it to be critical of things that the state sanctions? Is the state to say that what it sanctions must be accepted by a church? A dangerous precedent. Equally dangerous, however, is the situation where a church says, we do not believe that the state should sanction such a situation because we do not. And to maintain the distance, the necessary distance there, between church and state is, as we are currently seeing in all kinds of areas, a very complex issue. To mention just a handful of contentious questions. The state has, for half a century, sanctioned legal abortion. Significant and large religious communities consider this to be unacceptable. The state has found an accommodation of conscience on this issue, but debate goes on about the limits to what the church or other communities can do in pushing back against a social consensus and the limits of the social consensus narrowing the church's options. It's not an easy area. At present, the situation with the state's legalization of same-sex marriage poses very similar problems to most mainstream religious communities. And we have exactly the same kind of uneasy frontier, where the state is faced with communities whose conscience will not allow them to say yes to this, and yet the state recognizes that there is a case for allowing that conscientious space to persist. We are probably going to see in the next few years renewed pressure on the legalization of physician-assisted suicide. Again, most of the mainstream churches will have conscientious objection to this. The social consensus has moved and is moving on this matter. I mention these not to pretend that churches have one view on them or that there is a right answer, but simply to note the bare fact that these are areas where the conscience of certain communities of conviction is in tension with what the state permits. And where you have religious communities partnering with state institutions, not least in education, you have the potential for a clash. You will have a situation where teachers in church-related or faith-related schools may be obliged to educate their students about a polity that doesn't follow the doctrine of their own religious community, to help them to understand why it is that this is a legal liberty. The state is faced with allowing the expression of the fact of dissent. I don't think this is, in fact, an impossible standoff, but it's a very difficult one, and likely to get more difficult as the decades go on. And as I say, I mention it not to make a point in debate about the rights and wrongs of any of those issues, but to note the structural questions that arise on the basis of the overall picture of religious and political liberty I've been reflecting on. And in a sense, for this to happen without a sterile and destructive standoff means two things for church and state. It means for the church that the church, and I'm using church as a shorthand, of course, for other religious communities also, the church can't simply demand that agreed legal freedoms be limited. The church must recognize that there is a legal right which cannot be reduced or challenged. But the state can't simply require that conscience be changed or doctrine be changed. But if those two things are acknowledged, what I think follows is that both church and state can be changed by a continuing interaction and debate on these issues. It may be that on some issues, the social consensus pushes the church to rethinking aspects of its doctrine with, one hopes, theological responsibility. It could be that the church's articulation of conscientious dissent obliges the state to think again about a thin or inadequate argument for change or for moving on. So the model that I'm working with, what you might call the Actonian model, isn't one that simply leaves us with a standoff, but I hope allows for some genuine exchange and debate about these contentious and complex matters in the public arena. Acton's model, the model which Figgis calls that of the free church and the free state, the model which may or may not be, and there are plenty of people in this audience who know better than I, which may not be St. Thomas Aquinas' idea, that model importantly tells us something about the state, something which the state needs to hear, whether it calls itself secular or religious, something about the necessary humility that any state apparatus needs to cultivate if it's not to become totalitarian. The particular territories where conflict arises, like some of the issues I've already mentioned, may not be comfortable ones. They may be areas in which, within this audience, certainly within our churches, there is already debate. But the very fact of the abrasion, the tension there, does still tell us something about the need to remind the state of its limits and to remind the church that, as I said before, its job is not only to argue for exemption or special status, but to remind the state that it is not the sole form of belonging for citizens. You could put it epigrammatically, as some have, by saying that the best citizen is the person who is not only a citizen. The best citizen is the person who is not only a citizen, whose loyalty to the political unit is qualified, enriched, and fleshed out by other kinds of important, morally significant loyalties. But to move towards a conclusion, I don't think I need underline why some of these issues are pertinent literally today, because we have in the last 12 months seen an extraordinary resurgence across the globe of populism, of assumptions about popular will as the essence of democracy, about national self-determination, and a number of related matters which ought to give us cause for concern, which ought to prompt us to be philosophical in a sense a little more nuanced than that of the lady on the bus. And if I were trying to identify some of the areas where I see particular dangers and risks at the moment, I would, I think, see about half a dozen questions which require thinking through in the light of Acton's insights and all that goes with them. The first of these risks is what I've already noted: the confusion that currently exists about the nature of democracy, the blurring of boundaries between democratic decision and populist mandate, and what goes with that, the undermining of the legitimacy of a minority view. It's difficult enough at the best of times, but when you have extremely close popular votes, when, as in both the American election and in the British referendum last year, you have votes hovering around the 50% mark, what you're going to do with a dissident minority of 49% is rather a serious question. You need to have a good political perspective on why it's important that a minority should be attended to. You'd have to do that anyway with any minority, but when a minority is so large, there's a practical pressure, which I hope we shan't ignore. So that's my first area of concern: confusion about democracy and the resurgence of the unsettling language of the people's will. Secondly, there's what I think of as the unhelpful standoff between what's felt as state intrusion or pressure on religious expression and the hostile reaction of religious groups who want to defend their liberties. The standoff here means that the language of human rights and the language of religious liberty are, rather bizarrely and rather paradoxically, seen as opposed to one another. I think if we're confused about the language of democracy, we're often confused about the language of human rights. And this second area of concern has to do really with how we build bridges between the discourses of human dignity as theologically understood and human rights as legally understood. The broad perspective I've been outlining suggests that the two importantly, crucially, belong together, and that if that connection is broken, both suffer. So to challenge, to modify that unhelpful to-ing and fro-ing between worry about state intrusion, worry about human rights, is the second area where we need more attention. And it has to do, thirdly, with the fact that our discourse about human rights is often, as I've said, a somewhat bloodless matter. If it becomes a matter of individual entitlement, then something is missing. A discourse of rights without a discourse of dignity risks becoming, if not trivial, at least a recipe for endless contention and growing individualist rivalry. But that's related to my fourth area of concern, which is the erosion of hard thinking and good practice in civil society. A few years ago, we were hearing a good deal about the idea of a big society. And some of the language about that was designed to revitalize civil society in the sense of restoring some self-determination to local groups, some expression, some viable embodiment of the principle of subsidiarity in terms of Catholic social teaching. We are not now hearing very much of that language in the public political discourse of this country, or indeed elsewhere. I think it's arguable that in the United States, a better and more robust structure of local citizens' democracy in cities and communities would at least have softened the bitter sense of disempowerment which helped fuel the revolution against political elites. The fifth point I want to make is a predictable one, that along with the trivialization of some of our language of rights, along with the erosion of civil society, there is a commodification of our relationships. Function, exchangeability, market price dominates. And those of you who know Michael Sandel's excellent work from the United States will know something of the possible analyses you can offer of personal and social relations reduced to financial terms. Everything can be a commodity. Everything can be bought and sold. And that leads into what I described earlier as the reduction of the citizen to a state functionary, someone who is defined by output alone. And the last area of concern, though it's another contentious one, is yet again an area where our current debates seem very confused. And that's around the area of free speech and its limits. It seems rather bizarrely that when we weaken or hollow out our language of human dignity, we become more protective of one another's vulnerabilities at the same time that we become less confident of one another's strengths. That's to say, some of the anxiety about free speech, about the need to protect people from certain kinds of speech, while laudable in itself, can carry with it a fundamental lack of trust in the human adult's ability to digest, respond, and argue. I'm not in the least opposed to limits on what we call hate speech, on incitement to violence and violent speaking and attitudes. I'm concerned that if we simply allow this to run over the whole area of our public discussions, we shall be undermining the very possibility of argument. And to pick up a phrase I've used once or twice in the past, I think a good democracy is an argumentative democracy, and a good form of democratic pluralism is an interactive one. If we so interpret free speech as to limit the possibilities of interaction, we are once again in trouble. So in conclusion, I'm suggesting that to be concerned for political liberty is to be concerned about all of these issues. And for this particular audience, in this particular context, it seems important to recognize that the theological task is to understand religious liberty in a way that will contribute constructively to the debate about what a proper liberal democracy looks like. That's not to say that liberal democracy is a form of government which descends from heaven, that there are no other viable or just ways of running human society. But Winston Churchill was surely right in saying that democracy was the worst form of government apart from all the others. And given that this is what we have inherited and what we have to make sense of, I would say that there's quite a lot in our theological tradition, especially as interpreted by somebody like Acton or John Neville Figgis, which allows us the possibility of resisting some of the trends and concerns I've listed, resisting those in a more intelligent way. Thank you very much.